What is Patrata? Why is it a critical condition for receiving the grace and the boons of the divine? Hello everyone, I'm Pulkit Mathur, founder of The Spiritual Bee, and in this video, we shall take a dive into understanding the critical and fundamentally important Vedantic concept of Patrata. The word Patrata itself is derived from the Sanskrit word Patra, which means vessel. And so Patrata means being like a vessel capable of receiving something. Patrata in Vedanta thus signifies spiritual depth or the worthiness or the deservingness or the capacity or the eligibility of a sadhak to receive the grace of the divine. Now the reason it is so important for us to understand the Vedantic principle of Patrata is because, as many of us in India are aware, God-realized saints often perform certain acts which are usually termed as miracles by the common person. These acts include the curing of diseases, the elongation of a person's lifespan, the offering of divine protection and help in times of distress, the resolving of family, financial and other difficulties, the bestowing of prana through Shaktipath, the awakening of the Kundalini, as well as the granting of other advanced spiritual powers to a disciple. However, contrary to the widespread popular perception, such divine boons are not granted by God-realized sages willy-nilly and for free. Instead, as Pandit Shriram Sharma Acharya has emphasized, these boons are bestowed by a God-realized sage only with the aim of removing certain obstacles from the path of the disciple which are hindering the disciple's further spiritual development. In fact, before granting such boons, a responsible guru first judges the patrata of the disciple, whether the disciple is truly deserving of such acts of grace, by ascertaining whether such an act of grace would advance the disciple's spiritual development or retard it by pushing the disciple lower into the quagmire of laziness, greed and sensory enjoyment. Divine boons, Pandit Shriram Sharma Acharya tells us, are not granted for careless squandering in reckless sense enjoyment, merriment and for living an easy, relaxed life. They are given so that the disciple can fulfill some lofty aim and purpose. As a matter of fact, if divine boons were bestowed freely upon one and all, utter chaos would reign in the world. As we know from our ancient tales, when those possessing egotistical, demonic and tamasic tendencies, such as Bhasmasura, Kansa and Kumkarna, received divine powers, they brought mayhem upon themselves and the whole world. Therefore, divine boons are not granted willy-nilly to everyone. The aim and purpose for which the boon is being requested is kept in mind, and they're only given to deserving candidates who are working towards a high spiritual goal. For example, before Sri Ramakrishna left his body, he transferred all his spiritual powers to one person who was not only worthy enough to receive this gift, but who would also utilize it for the well-being and upliftment of all. Who was this person? It was Swami Vivekananda. Note that Sri Ramakrishna did not bestow his spiritual powers to just about anyone who asked him for them, but he was judicious and careful. It was because of his guru's gift of divine powers that Swami Vivekananda, without having a penny in his pocket, was able to spread the light of Vedanta to the whole world and set up the Ramakrishna Mission, an institution which has now lasted for over 100 years. Because of his guru's gift, Swamiji was able to achieve all this in a short span of just 8 years. So it is very important for us to remember that the grace of God, as well as that of a God-realized guru, both of which are actually one and the same, this divine grace or kripa as it is called in Hindi is never free. It has to be earned and it is available only to the spiritually deserving. For even though God-realized gurus possess so much power that they can will entire universes into existence, still they do not violate the spiritual laws on which the cosmos runs, such as the law of karma, unnecessarily and without justification. To better understand this point, consider the following example. Suppose a habitual alcoholic suffering from liver cirrhosis requests a God-realized guru for a cure. However, since the person has not put in any effort to develop and strengthen his willpower, after receiving the cure, he goes right back to his old ways of drinking. In this case, the person has not only wasted the divine grace, but the guru too, by bestowing an immediate cure upon a weak-willed person, has violated the cosmic law of karma unnecessarily. He has retarded the disciple's spiritual development because he has not let the disciple strengthen his will. Making matters worse, the guru has wrongly placed before the world the idea that there is no need for purushartha or self-effort, One need not work hard for anything. One could remain immersed in reckless sense enjoyment, and when one lands in trouble, the only thing one has to do is to chase down the right guru, and like a genie, he will set everything right again. So patrata, that is the deservingness of the disciple, is of paramount importance. As Swami Sivananda has explained, the aspirant before he desires the grace of the master should deserve it, and the supply of divine grace comes only when there is a real thirst in the aspirant and when he is fit to receive it. Now at this point one may question, you say that the guru judges the patrata of the disciple, but isn't a God-realized guru who has attained oneness with God himself, isn't such a guru supposed to be a boundless ocean of compassion and mercy from whose door no one returns empty-handed, for his kripa, his grace, just like God's, is showered equally upon the worthy and the unworthy, the deserving and the undeserving? And the answer is yes, this statement is no doubt also true, but we must remember that to each the guru can give only according to their capacity to receive. Just as rain falls freely, but we can gather for ourselves only in proportion to the capacity of the bowl in our hand, similarly, the amount of grace we can receive depends upon our patrata. As Mother Meera has explained, who is worthy or unworthy in front of the divine grace? All are children of the one and the same mother. Her love is equally spread over all of them. But to each one, she gives according to his nature and receptivity. Everyone is given his chance and the help is there for all. But for each, the benefit is proportionate to his sincerity. In this quote, we should note that Mother Meera is referring to God in the feminine gender as the Shakti or the creative force aspect of the infinite divine consciousness. So to conclude, if we wish to receive the divine grace of God or that of a God-realized guru, it is very important that we continuously struggle to deepen our patrata, our deservingness and our capacity to receive this grace. And the way we can deepen our patrata is by working hard to purify our inner nature through the conscious cultivation of sattvic qualities such as truthfulness, sincerity, straightforwardness, self-control, courage and compassion, which can counter and erase the embedded egoistic habits and selfish tendencies. Only when we succeed in thus deepening our patrata can we become worthy recipients of the divine's grace. Otherwise, just like the shallow bowl which did not work hard to develop its capacity and its deservingness to receive, we too will go empty-handed. As Lord Krishna has said in the Gita, Uddharet Atmanat Manam, do Purushartha, work hard, put in the self-effort to raise yourself by yourself. Strive for inner self-refinement or Atma Parishkar. Just as a professor will not answer the questions for you and make you pass, you too must work out your own salvation. Only when you do Purushartha to refine your inner self will the divine grace come. If God so wishes, He can give mukti, that is freedom from the cycles of birth and death, to the whole world in an instant. But He does not do so. Grace descends only when there is Purushartha. So let us strive to become worthy recipients of the divine's grace by putting in Tivra Purushartha, that is by putting in tremendous hard work to overcome our ego. Let us steadily pursue the path of truth and shun all falsehood, and above all, let us develop sincerity and a firm faith in the divine. With this, we reach the end of this video. As always, thanks for watching, and we shall meet again in the next video.